So the first thing to sort of wrap your mind around this is that the project has to be appropriate in size and scope. You're a new researcher. You have sort of limited background because you're new. You probably have limited resources because you're new to your university and they didn't give you all the startup you asked for, despite what Steve told you to ask for. So it has to be appropriate inside, ready to go, lab space, target population, research team. Everything has to be in place. The grant is not to get things in place. The grant is when you have it already established. It's to pay for things that are already there, ready to launch. It has to be demonstrably feasible. This is hugely important. Demonstrably feasible for quick recruitment. For an R03, things have to happen very fast, right? For a 2 or 3 year award, you can't waste, you know, the first 6 months getting geared up, right? That's not what they want to see. So it has to be demonstrably feasible for quick recruitment, data acquisition, analysis, and write-up. You want a product in 3 years. So a 5-year project, on the other hand, for an R01, if that's what you're working on, that's a much larger budget. Not only is it a much, you know, a longer time, but it's a much larger budget. It's going to have a much larger team, and it should be sufficiently complex, well planned, and conceptually deep to warrant this kind of large commitment. So you really have to show you know what you're doing organizationally as well as scientifically. And then for training or career development mechanisms, so if you're going to be working on an F-30, well, probably not an F-31, but an F-32 or a K award, K-99, R-00, or K-08, K-03, K-21, K-23, so all of those are sort of possibilities. Then the research plan has to have real training potential. You know, it's going to take you to a new place. And that has to be a place that your sponsor can take you better than anybody else. This is the best person on the planet to train you in those new techniques in a well-funded environment that's already doing all of that stuff, and that it builds perfectly on your own background. So these aims, you can see from this, depending on what the mechanism is, your aims are doing different things. That's all this slide is supposed to tell you. You have to make sure that you know what you're writing for, okay? What's your objective? So I want you to look at this part. So innovating within the framework. So they don't teach Thomas Kuhn anymore. This is history and philosophy of science kind of stuff. So Thomas Kuhn had this idea that advanced this idea that's, you know, really relevant to a lot of what we do. Normal science is sort of the incremental things that we're all just contributing. We're all just, you know, cogs in a wheel, right? We're just all grinding toward the same solution. Human Genome Project was sort of the perfect example, right? It took way more than a village, right? It was millions of people working on this project, literally millions of people. So that's kind of normal science. Everybody's contributing, you know, what they do. But then comes along something revolutionary sciences, which is mostly what young investigators really aspire to do and actually what Steve Barlow actually does. And that's just sort of to take the paradigm and sort of change directions, right? You're thinking about things in a whole new way. And we all want to do that. And you think that's what grant reviewers are looking for. And it's not actually what they're looking for. They don't trust you to do that. This is an important point. What reviewers want you to do is they want you to be right at the fence line where you're just sort of leaning against the fence. So, you know, the walking the fence line is like when, you know, if you're a cowboy, that's what you do every morning. You make sure, well, actually it takes 3 months. You ride the whole fence line and make sure everybody's, you know, the fence is intact and keeps all the little doggies inside. That's where you want to work is right. You don't want to be, you know, deep inside the known universe, but you don't want to be outside the fence line either. You don't want to be outside where, you know, none of your colleagues are working. You don't want to be working on your own. Right, without the support of known science, known concepts, known phenomena, right? But you don't want to be working too much inside the safe zone. You feel like science is enormous and you can work anywhere you want, but in grant world, you can work in this little narrow strip around the fence line, is the point I'm trying to make. This is a really tortured analogy. Holy cow, I wish I could rewind. But the idea is you're going to take sort of the existing body of knowledge, and you're just going to make it a little bit larger, as much as one lab can. So you have to be a little bit safe, but you have to be a little bit innovative, and you have to push a little bit, but not too much. Right? I mean, there's a sweet spot there. So that's what you're looking for. So what helps you find that spot is that you have unique talents. Your unique talents come from your training. You trained in a lab with a person who has their own unique talents, and they give you your own capabilities. You've done dissertations that sort of define and have sharpened your talents. You know, you have things that you bring uniquely to this problem. So you have to recognize those right at the beginning and exploit those. This isn't the time to, you know, go do something brand new. This is the time to say why, you know, to recognize why you're in the unique position to address this piece of the fence line. I'm not going to refer to it again, I promise. So be aware of that, you know, what you bring to the problem, be aware of what that is when you're starting to work on your aims and work on what your project is. Okay, so we're getting ready to think about starting a new project, concept, or notion. We're going to suggest an idea. So you demonstrated that strengths, the first part of your assessment, right? What do you bring? What's your preparation? What's your demonstrated preparation? Not what are you really good at? What are you demonstrably good at? What have you published in? What was your dissertation in? You know, no, the claims that you make really have very little to do with your demonstrated strengths and preparation, okay? What can you show? The most important thing you can do is identify something that you can demonstrate as being feasible. So for new investigators, one of the biggest problems you'll run up against is that you'll propose something that might be a great idea, but people don't really get that far because they decide it's not feasible. It's not feasible either because you don't have the preparation or you don't have the training or whatever, but maybe it's not feasible just because they don't believe you, because you haven't demonstrated it. You have to show that it's feasible. You have to provide evidence that says, oh, yes, I can do this experiment. I've run this protocol. I have these streams of subjects already lined up. I have a letter of support that says they're all lined up. The lab I have is already appropriately equipped and supported. Okay, so everything you claim to need is in place, including your own capabilities. And maybe most importantly in terms of feasibility is if you don't have the expertise yourself, the expertise in terms of support of other key personnel. So that's your team. So this is, you've already sort of heard this idea, is understanding what your scientific area is and how your idea fits into that. This is sort of recognition of your place in the scientific context. And now your demonstrable team. So you can claim a team all day long, but until you've demonstrated the logistical connections of that team, the best way to demonstrate a connected team is that you publish together. But you're brand new, and putting together a team in time to publish, in time to submit something is ridiculous, right? It's never going to happen if you wait that long. But you can have lab meetings. You can participate in journal clubs. You can have regular meetings that you can document. You can present to each other's journal clubs or to colloquia. You can co-present in presentations, conference presentations that you put together. So there are ways to show that you interact with people who are part of your team, and that's important to do. So one of the most difficult problems for new investigators is the scope of your idea. We'll come to this in a minute, but the number one and most damaging concern that reviewers will lead with, and then you're all done, actually. If the primary reviewer utters this word, you're all done. And that is overambitious. You go into this project and you feel so sort of compelled to show that you can do it, and you want to do things like, you know, give added value, like I'm only going to charge you $300 for this, but I'm going to give you $400,000 worth of effort. You know, that's not compelling. What's compelling is that you know exactly what you're doing and that what you're proposing is not only feasible, but you know so much about it that you've actually, you know, proposed exactly the right amount of work for this amount of time. You know exactly how long it takes to run a subject, how long it takes to process their data, how long it takes to, you know, do the analysis and write it up. So getting all of that stuff done, knowing that much about your work and having preliminary data that support that will guide you to something that has an appropriate appropriate breadth. Okay. Most important thing is guidance from your program officer. So this is another just sort of crazy thing that new investigators, you know, the corners that we put ourselves in, which is the program officer's job is to talk to you and to provide guidance. And you can have a 10-minute conversation with your program officer that will completely change, you know, or completely form what you're going to do in terms of seeking support for your research. And yet we're sort of, you know, afraid to reveal our naivete to this program officer, I guess. And so, you know, you're sort of worried about making that call. And so people often, I mean, way too often, more often than not, people send in applications without ever contacting their program officer. Your program, here's how you do this. And none of you will ever make this mistake of not doing this ever again, because I'm going to tell you how to do this. You've identified the program officer associated with your program. If you're in language, disorders, then that's Judith Cooper. If you're in speech disorders, that's Lana Shackham. If you're in hearing, it's Amy Donahue. So, or quite a few other possibilities. But you identify who is your program officer. That's not a hard thing to do, you know, trolling through the websites. You send that person a 3-line email, and it says, I'm interested in the possibility of applying to your institute for support. Would you have 10 minutes to talk? Here's a whole bunch of times that I'm available. That's all that email says. And then you get 15 minutes with that person on the phone at a scheduled time. You're ready for them with your specific aims or whatever, which maybe you're going to send it to them right away after your conversation, and you're going to find out if the mechanism you're applying for is appropriate, if the institute you're targeting is appropriate. Maybe they will even give you guidance on which study section you might like to recommend to the review officers. So, you know, you can accomplish some really important things in 15 minutes, and why people wouldn't do it, I don't know. What you'll never succeed at is calling that number, like they give the phone numbers on the website. You will never reach them at that phone number. Don't even try that. Set up a phone appointment and make it a short email, because that's how far down that email you'll be able to get. Okay? So do you understand what you have to do there? I do not want to let that go past. That's the most important thing I have to tell you. Okay, so we got this already. Stick with your strengths and your proven history. Not a time to try new techniques. An approach for which you can provide published evidence, that's that you and your team are experienced and capable. It doesn't mean that you or your team actually generated that published evidence, right? There has to be, I'm talking about just having published, you know, peer-reviewed support, okay? So think creatively, be innovative, and keep an eye on the big picture, but also be aware of, you know, the fact that you are only one lab and that it's a big field and, you know, what's an appropriate size for your project. So this comes in here where you're recognizing the place of your work in the overall framework. Where, you know, what are you trained to do? What are you best capable of? Where are you best capable of contributing, right? And what that does is puts you solidly in the stream of ideas, not just of your group, but of your peers or of science generally. If you find yourself working in an area where it's interesting how often this happens, is people will often lead their specific aims with the idea that there's a paucity of information or a paucity of literature in this area. And as if that is some kind of motivation for this study. You know, the reason nobody's doing work in that area is because there's no reason to work in that area. Or because it's just too uninteresting, or because it's not going to help anybody, or it's too expensive, or it's, you know, it's just a dumb idea, or, you know. I mean, there are lots of good reasons not to do work in an area, and there's really very few reasons to do work in that area. So if you find yourself working in working on something where your best motivation is a paucity of other investigators working there, you should really look around and see if, you know, other people have something figured out that you haven't figured out. So you should work harder. You know, maybe it is really an important idea, and maybe you just don't know the literature. I mean, we have a small discipline, right? And so our literature isn't huge. So maybe the literature that influences your science isn't actually right in your immediate neighborhood. Maybe there's really great work, it's just not quite, you know, where you would exactly expect to find it, you know, in the speech section of JSLHR. That might not be what's motivating your work, right? So the point is, there has to be a solid stream, you know, a dynamic series of experiments, you know, and scientific work where you can put yourself right in the middle of it. Okay, if you can't do that, you know, there's something wrong. Something, you know, seriously wrong. So don't do that.